Hello students, welcome to Laex Excellence. Welcome to the 61st weekly magazine where we'll be covering from 23rd April to 29th April 2018. So let's quickly get into what are the important issues in this particular week. So as you're all aware, we are giving you an essay every week. So now once prelims gets over, I want you people to take each one of these topics that are given here and try to write essays, practice writing. From the information that you have already, try to structure the arguments as much as possible. These 3 months are very crucial for those people who are preparing for mains. So for you people, especially from mains orientation, we are giving you these essays. Please ensure that you are going to answer them. And if at all you want to get it evaluated, right, in the website provided, you can actually send all your answer sheets there. We will evaluate and we will give feedback as well. Fine. So once this is clear, I want to take up the second issue or second important event which is occurring in the coastal region. Especially this has affected Kerala coast. What is this? You have different types of waves, and these waves are named on the basis of its height. It may be named on the basis of the speed, right? So if we talk about this particular wave which is affecting Kerala coast, is actually known as swell waves. What do you understand by swell waves? In wave terminology, or when we look at waves, we say that wind is the most important aspect which actually leads to formation of waves. And when we are looking at these waves, right, over a particular area, fetch, right, if you have the wind moving over that particular area, when the interaction between the wind and the ocean surface is significantly high, then the depth of the waves will also vary. Here I want you to know that whenever there is a wave movement, it is only energy which is moving, but the particles within the wave doesn't move. If you actually see the wave movement, right, it looks like this, and the particles move in a circular format actually, right? But when you hit the coast, then this is going to be affected. And there you get either erosion or deposition on the basis of the slopes. Now, what is this swell waves? So these are waves whose wavelength is usually greater. Why the wavelengths are more? The reason for increasing wavelength in this particular region is because of the speed with which the wind is hitting the sea surface. Now, these waves are believed to be originated in the southern ocean, that is just above Antarctica. Here, westerly winds will be blowing. And if you are aware, usually on the basis of the latitude, we usually name westerlies as roaring 40s. Furious 50s, shrieking 60s. Why? Here the land is almost absent and the wind is moving with a greater speed, and as there is no frictional force, right, the impact of the wind on the water is more and the wind speed is not reduced because of the friction. So here I'm just trying to tell you, westerlies in the mid latitudes, when they are moving, they are not disrupted much in the southern hemisphere, due to which the speed with which they will be moving is usually higher. And whenever the speed with which they move is more, right, they hit the water and there will be huge wave formation, and the wavelength of this will be normally more. And here I want you to know, because of fronts, or because of any process, If there we observe any meeting of air masses, even this will have huge impact on the water surface. Now, because of this, if the waves have been generated and these waves, if they move across, it is believed that the waves generated in the Southern Ocean is actually reaching most of the places, and especially it is reaching Kerala coast. And now when it affects the Kerala coast, there is a fear that most of the people who are present in between high tide and low tide will be affected. In the previous video, we actually spoke about the coastal zones, right? In the coastal regulation zone, this is one of the most important thing which may also affect. So the government is actually conscious, and it is trying to tell to the people that, like, you know, when you are moving during this particular period when the waves are more, try to be careful. Fine. So this concept is important for you. So the next issue that we need to see is about the North Korea or the Korean Peninsula as a whole. Here, as you're all aware, today Korean crisis or Korean Peninsula is very, very important. And they may ask about this not only in prelims but also in mains. And they may ask you about the Korean crisis in world history as well. And here, you must be aware that there is a topic in mains about the colonization and decolonization processes. When we talk about the decolonization process, we usually focus on the African countries or Asian countries which were actually ruled by the British. But unfortunately, there are few areas which were ruled by the Asians and they are never considered or read. One such area which has seen lot of fight is the Korean Peninsula. And this has also helped the world community, or if you look at the world powers, US and USSR, to decide what India actually did during this particular period. So let us see in detail what is the Korean crisis, where did it start, what exactly is happening, and how this is going to be resolved, right? So I just don't want you to remember all the factual data. I'll just help you to understand some important aspects with respect to this. Fine. So the first important thing that we all need to see when we look at this particular peninsula is that it is surrounded by certain oceans or seas. Correct? You have LOC, you have Japan Sea, all this. But what is more important historically if we see? This was considered to be part of the Chinese kingdom. And when there was some crisis, then the new kingdom which came to power in the Korean Peninsula called this particular area to be a Korean dynasty or under the rule of Korean kingdom. Now, after Chinese influence, these people were under the control of Russia or USSR. But once Japan defeated Russia, this region became part of what we call as Japan, or Japan colonized it. And once Japan controlled it, even the internal matters of this was controlled, and it was one after the other. Japan actually saw some sort of humiliation when Europeans defeated Japan and imposed certain trade restrictions on them. And these trade restrictions were actually benefiting only the Europeans but not Japanese. Once the Korea came under the control of Japan, Japan started imposing similar restrictions which European countries had imposed on Japan. And this Japanese domination was not liked by the Korean kings. So at this point of time, the Korean kings went to China and Russia for help. And when there were few crises, especially farmer crisis in Korea, Korean queen requested agreements with China instead of going to Japan. At this point of time, Japan became very much angry about the Korean queen, and it is believed that the queen was assassinated and the Korea came under the control of Japan. And once Hiroshima and Nagasaki was bombarded, we actually observe from the north, the Russia or USSR started attacking, and from the south, United States and the other forces started attacking. Now, both these actually reached 38th parallel and both agreed for a ceasefire at 38th parallel. Now, they went to United Nations, and United Nations said that we should have elections. Let people of Korea decide what they want, because northern part was under the control of Russia and they were talking about communism. Southern part was under the control of US and they were talking about democracy. At this point of time, when United Nations said that democracy should be there, Russia boycotted it. So elections were held only in South Korea and it became Republic of Korea, whereas the northern part became People's Republic of Korea. And here also elections were held with only one party, and this led to separate, like, you know, North Korea and South Korea. Both North Korea and South Korea were unhappy about this development, and North Korea felt that Korea has to be one, and they, with the help of Russia, they started attacking United States, or they started attacking the South Korea. And the war went on to such an extent that by the time United States started taking permission from UN and all, like, you know, almost the entire region was under the control of USSR. Now, US and other forces again started attacking from south. Now, everyone came at one particular place, right? That is, again, they went back. And ceasefire was conducted by United Nations. And now the zone that you have is the demilitarized zone. And today, both the countries, especially North Korea and South Korea, have actually addressed or trying to address this issue, where the North Korean president for the first time has actually agreed to cross to South Korea, and he has crossed. Even the South Korean president crossed the North Korea or entered into North Korea, and this is where the peace process is actually starting. Now, Kim's father was the one who actually started with the nuclear weapons. It is believed that Pakistan has given whatever information or technology required to produce these nuclear weapons. There were huge sanctions on Pakistan during this particular period, but Pakistan said that officially it is not the state which has given it, but the Pakistan's nuclear father, a father of nuclear weapons, he agreed that yes, it's me who have provided this technology to North Korea, and Pakistan as a state is not aware of this. So, he protected Pakistan army, and then there was removal of sanctions on Pakistan. But once they started developing this, earlier North Korea was actually part of NPT. They withdrew from NPT and they started testing the nuclear weapons. They started developing and testing nuclear weapons. Several times, P5 countries plus one, like, you know, Germany, and sometimes even South Korea used to sit and they discuss with North Korea about how to denuclearize the entire Korean Peninsula. And fortunately, the Korean Peninsula or North Korea is now agreeing to remove the nuclear weapons that they have. And if they remove it completely, then that would be a great day for the world, because North Korea was considered as a rogue state. And they had weapons of mass destruction. And if they use this across different countries, or if they use it against different countries, it would be dangerous. Most importantly, if they sell it to terrorists or others, then it would have become dangerous to the world. India recently went to North Korea and had an agreement where North Korea had actually promised that any activity of North Korea will not have any impact on India. So many people also predicted that if there is pseudo war, then North Korea may attack India on behalf of China, and that would be a disaster. But fortunately, North Korea has said that its foreign policy with India will be independent of any other country. And India is also establishing formal relationship with North Korea. So over a period of time, if the Korean Peninsula, if Korean Peninsula can be denuclearized, it would be very, very beneficial. Here I told you that India's support to US or USSR during the Cold War was dependent on the Korean crisis. Here, as I told you, when North Korea was actually fighting South Koreans, at that point of time, the world community said that what North Korea has done is wrong, and India supported United States during this time. Russia and others felt that India is supporting US. Whereas, once US, UN and other forces started attacking South Korea from down, then India supported Russia and said that this is not the way to deal with this issue. We should have convinced them to go for democracy. At that point of time, US actually felt that India is biased towards Russia, and Russia also tried to ensure that they maintain good relations with India. But till 1970s, we observe both USSR and US having good relations with India, and Russia was balancing both China and India. So all these are important when we look at the Korean crisis. Fine guys, if this is clear from now on, whenever you read newspaper, some issues will be very much clear. So let's move to next issue. So the next issue that we need to see is about the National Minority Commission, which is seeking constitutional status. So what is the meaning of this? When we say there are constitutional bodies and non-constitutional bodies, National Minority Commission also comes under this. Now in India, we have six communities whom we call as minorities. I'll come to those factual things. Once if this becomes constitutional, or once if it gets the constitutional status, then the advantage of this is that the committee's report has to be taken seriously. It has to be placed, and whatever recommendations they give has to be implemented. And that will ensure the protection of the minorities. Now, whatever they do, even though on paper it looks like they will be implemented, it, they are not the authority to guide and say that this is how it should be done. So let us see some facts with respect to National Minority Commission. So when we talk about the National Minority Commission, it was set up in 1992, and there are six religious communities which are considered to be minorities: Muslims, Christians, Sikhs, Buddhists, Parsis and Jains, right? Earlier there were only five religious communities. Jains have been added recently. And now when you look at the composition, right, they have a chairperson, vice chairperson, five members to be nominated by the central government from amongst persons of eminence, ability and integrity. See, they have not clearly mentioned who should be, provided that five members including the chairperson shall be from amongst the minority communities. So this is very, very important. So they may say all the members should be from the minority community, right? Then grievance redressal: aggrieved persons belonging to the minority communities may approach the concerned state minority commissions for redressal of their grievances. They may also send their representations to the National Commission for Minorities after exhausting all remedies available to them. That is, if nothing is able to solve their problems, then they can send it to the National Commission. Second important thing, in few states, Hindus are minority, and these communities are now requesting, or these states are requesting to give Hindus' minority status in those states. So should we go for state-wise minority communities? Then several communities has to be considered as minorities. So we have to see each one of these over a period of time. The next important issue is about Fugitive Economic Offenders Ordinance 2018. You are aware about Nirav Modi and all. Daily you are seeing in newspaper the government's measures to bring them back. One serious effort taken by the government is to ensure that they will be or they would be given arrest warrant. And once, if you call that person as a fugitive economic offender, right, who is that person? Who against whom an arrest warrant has been issued in respect of scheduled offence and who has left India so as to avoid criminal prosecution, right? So what is a scheduled offence here? List of economic offences contained in the schedule of this ordinance, whatever the ordinance talks, and it is associated with economic offences. Now what are the provinces or provisions? First important thing is about the special court will be there, so it will take up the cases quickly. Second important thing, the government will have the power to attach properties. Here they are thinking of not only attaching Indian properties but also properties outside India. Until and unless that is there, see, for example, what happens, you might be an offender and you, government has to take money from you. At this point of time, what these people will do, they may transfer it to somebody's name or they may put it in some other company accounts, so that when they try to separate it, and if you have done anything, like for example Mallya, he has lot of companies, but the failure was only in right particular airlines, not in all other things. Now the government, if it goes for something of this sort, then they can actually take stake of the others as well. So this is important. Trial in the PMLA courts, right, that is Prevention of Money Laundering Act courts, in that only the trials will be held and there would be no immunity to offenders, and the main aim is deportation, that is bring them back to India. One of the major thing that the public is actually feeling, that capitalism is bad, right? So even if you look at economic survey, they had said about something known as stigmatized capitalism. The meaning of stigmatized capitalism is there is a fear that these capitalists are not going to do anything good for the country. They are here to make money and escape. So this mindset, if it has to be removed, then these type of things are very, very important. So the next issue that we need to see is about the scheduled areas declaration in Rajasthan. Is it important? Yes. So what exactly does this mean? Here we need to see that in Rajasthan, some areas are newly described under the fifth schedule. Who has the power? President by order can declare that these are the scheduled areas. So alteration of the boundaries are taking place, where the governor of the state, in consultation, right, with the government and all, they will try to ensure that scheduled areas are being given. The current scheduled areas are, like, you know, in Andhra Pradesh you have Telangana, you have Gujarat, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, Himachal Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Odisha and Rajasthan. You have scheduled areas under fifth schedule. Then what is or who takes care of the administration of scheduled areas? The executive power of the union shall extend to giving directions to the respective states regarding the administration of the scheduled areas. Most importantly, the governors of the state, like, you know, they can decide whether a particular act of the state will be applicable to the tribal areas or not, so that some measures taken by the state government which is against the interest of the tribal communities should not be introduced. And you will have tribal advisory councils where MLAs, MPs from these particular areas will be part of it, and they will suggest to governor what measures need to be taken to ensure that these areas or these tribal communities are benefited. And then the governor is authorized to direct that any particular act, as I told you, governor will tell whether a particular act is applicable or not. Governor may make regulations for the peace and good governance of any area in a state which is for the time being a scheduled area. So anything which is good for this particular area can be done by the governor. And remember, it is the president who can actually say that a particular area is scheduled area. The next important issue is about Unnat Bharat Abhiyan. This was asked in prelims already. It is about higher education, right? So there are several higher education institutions which are coming together to ensure that rural India will be benefited, where they will take up the programs, right, which will actually benefit the problems or which will try to remove the problems of the rural India, right? One important thing is here their main aim is building institutional capacity in institutions of higher education in research and training relevant to the needs of the rural India. So it is something similar to what they do in Israel and all. That is, institutions will take up the problems of the rural areas and they will try to find solution to those particular problems. So today, institutions or our colleges, or if you see the newspaper and all, lot of criticism is there about the PhD and all, that these people are taking up some issues which are not relevant to the society. So once if they can take up issues which are relevant to the society, the scholarship and others which government is spending on these will be beneficial. And when we talk about the lab to land, we also have to talk about research to, like, you know, reality, where problems have to be taken and solutions for those particular problems have to be found. Next, from this year prelims and also next year prelims, one important thing is always about the GI tag, and it has to be updated regularly. For those who are preparing for 2019, my suggestion is from now on, whenever we give you this GI tags, make a separate note of it and try to see which areas and what have been given, right? This geographical indicator tag. Adilabad, Dokra, Warangal, Darris. Yes. So these have been given GI tag. What it is, very rare they may ask you, but still, it is an ancient metal craft that is popular in the state's tribal regions. And just now you saw Telangana has one of the largest tribal population. The uniqueness of this art form is that no two sculptures are the same, as they are not made out of a pre-designed cast. The meaning of this is whenever you go for metal craft, you might have seen, like, you know, in a wood or so, they usually make some holes and they pour the, like, you know, liquid metal into that, and once it gets solidified, the shape will be obtained. But here the beauty of this is each one is different from the other. The craftsmen belong to the Voj community, commonly referred as Ojaris or Ojas. They use brass as their main material and an ancient casting technique called Sire Perdue, I don't know how you pronounce it. They wrap the clay with the wax threads before making the mold so that the wax melts away and the molten metal is poured into the mold. No need of all these. Warangal Darris, in the style of Darris, weavers create beautiful patterns and dye them using vegetable colors, very, very important, which are washed in flowing water after the printing process. It's very, very important because it will be biodegradable. Next, AFSPA, Armed Forces Special Power Act in Meghalaya. Northeast India is having this issue of Armed Forces Special Power Act. Even in Jammu Kashmir, you listen to that, but because of increasing militancy from Pakistan, like, you know, the talks about removing AFSPA from Jammu Kashmir is less. But when we talk about the Northeast India, initially most of these places were under AFSPA because of the increasing events of fights of insurgency, which was supported by Myanmar, Bangladesh, China and many other countries. And today we have governments which support India in Myanmar, governments which support India in Bangladesh. China used to indirectly help these insurgency groups via Myanmar and Bangladesh. And it is believed that Chinese sell, like, you know, lot of small weapons in this particular region. And this region has one of the largest small weapons in the world. All these will ensure that army has to be present in this particular area to ensure that the insurgency, which is aimed at overthrowing the governments by outside powers, has to be prevented. And now in certain areas where the peace has prevailed, there are talks that this has to be removed, right? So slowly they are trying to remove it, but it would take a lot of time. The next important thing is about the draft mission to kickstart renewable energy storage. One of the major problem for renewable energy in India is it is not integrated into the power grids. Second important problem is we do not have proper batteries to store them. So once if we can do these two, then it would be very much beneficial for us to ensure that wherever from renewable energy excess production is there, that can be transferred to the power grids and it can be sold as well. Until and unless you commercialize it, until and unless you sell it, there is no use of producing more than a particular point. So that is one point. Second important thing, if you can get batteries in those areas which are Naxal affected or where power grid facilities are less, there you can ensure that the energy is produced, stored, and it can be used in the seasons when the renewable energy cannot be harnessed. Then guys, the other important thing similar to GI tag I want to make notes is about the exercises. Harimau Shakti, Indo-Malaysian Defense Cooperation, where these two are coming together for a joint military exercise in dense forests of Sengai. Is it important? Yes. When we are talking about Northeast India, which is having similar environmental facilities like the Malaysia and all, there if we are going for training of our guards, Malaysians will be having the technology, what you have to use and how you have to attack the people and all, that will actually help our soldiers also to fight against the insurgency in Northeast. And the last important issue is about MSMEs will play a key role in employment generation, Suresh Prabhu. So what is the most important aspect here? I want you to know that even economic survey has constantly said that MSMEs will play a very important role when it comes to foreign trade. They are playing a very important role when it comes to employment opportunities. They are playing a very important role when it comes to contribution in GDP and all, taxes, anything you take, the contribution of MSMEs is more. And there is a particular chapter in economic survey which actually says that MSMEs, in India, most of the growth is egalitarian, where not few corporate houses are trying to control the market, but mostly the market is controlled by MSMEs, and they are planning to ensure that schemes specific to MSMEs has to be encouraged, loans and all has to be encouraged, so that these people have the capacity to go for new innovations, or the small can become medium, right, and the medium can become big houses, so that the employment facilities can be further increased. So over a period of time, India had chosen to be state will also develop, at the same time the private players will also participate in the economy. When you have mixed economy, egalitarian societies, if it is there, and if India can focus on MSMEs, that would be very, very helpful for the overall growth of the economy. Guys, after seeing this, I hope you will start writing answers for ethics as well. Right? And please send this to our website, which is given. And the second important thing is we are starting new batch in June. Those who are interested across India, you can come down. So we cannot come, but we need your modules. You can contact us, the number given. And the most important thing is we are starting online optionals as well. I'll be taking geography optional completely. Those who have already prepared, and if you want to go for test series or anything, you can contact us. Only 20 students will be given test series, because personally, if I have to monitor, I can only evaluate 20. So whoever is interested can contact immediately after your prelims. Thank you guys. Thanks for watching.